Good evening and welcome to the Pinken Show live.
Live
on Mustard and on YouTube. It's the Norwich City fanzine that can now definitely hear a fat lady singing. Lots to get through tonight, including that depressing weekend defeat, that dismal draw last night, that tirade against his teammates from Cameron Jerome, and even Alec Neil having a pop at that man on my left. Oh, wow. Cleaner. Okay, we've got a oh dear. We've got a few angry fans on the phone too. Don't pull that face. So tonight could get feisty, but bringing a touch of calm to proceedings, maybe. We have a top punditry trio of City boss botherer.
Look what I've done now.
Darren Eadie, look at the state of that table. Darren Eadie.
It's been labelled with something there. It's a bit harsh, that.
Well, you know, I didn't write it. The voice of football, Dan O'Hagan. I love that, Dan. And City fan and former programme editor, Peter Rogers.
Evening.
Good evening. There'll be plenty of opinion flying about. And if you want to add yours, get in touch now on Twitter, Facebook, or via the YouTube live chat, which is currently going on my phone.
Live.
Live. But before all that, it's time for the headlines. They think it's all over. It probably is now. Yay. A 5-1 drubbing at Wednesday, followed by a solitary point on Tuesday, has just about put paid to any lingering promotion hopes City fans may have had. The playoffs are still mathematically possible, just not very realistically probable. So, that's that for another season. Stressed to the nines. It's not just me either. Another stat to darken the mood. City sit eighth in the championship, and yet with just 11 games to go, they are still to beat anyone in the top nine. Fixtures against Preston, Fulham, Leeds, Reading, Brighton and Huddersfield remain. The omens don't look good. R-E-S-P-E-C-T, don't know what it means, says he. The gallery liked that one. Cameron Jerome pulled no punches. It wasn't in tune. In his post-match interview at Hillsborough, in telling his teammates to pull their fingers out, he basically implied they've been sticking them up at fans, at management, and even at each other every time City have crumbled. According to Cam Jam, the Canaries' capacity for capitulation all boils down to a lack of respect. The Hunger Games. Wow, look at that picture.
Kind of suits him.
Alec Neil will love that. Alec Neil, speaking of him, seemed to agree with Cameron Jerome, shooting back at those like Darren, who have questioned his team's fitness this season. He said a lack of hunger was more likely behind the losses than any lack of fitness. That and being deprived of people like Graham Dorans, Yusuf Malumbu and Louis Thompson for long periods. We'll see what Darren makes of that in a minute. But for now, finally. No, Ranger danger! Alec Neil was linked with the Rangers job, but that now looks like going to the Portuguese coach of Qatar's Al Garrafa Sports Club, Pedro Caiginha.
Good work. So,
thank you. Lots of hyphens in that. So that's one less thing for Norwich fans to worry about. There we go. Gentlemen, what a pleasure it is to see you tonight. How are we all?
Very good.
Yes.
Very good.
Football aside, very good, yes.
Football aside, yep. It's going to make for a great hour of television. first up, I mean, fresh back from Ashton Gate, which is a fantastic stadium now, by the way. And there were big changes, weren't there, as Norwich headed into that, which is probably more interesting than the game and the result itself. Tim Closter, John Ruddy, Wes Hooland, Jacob Murphy were the guys who missed out. What did we make of those changes?
Well, I think we've seen it all before. There's been times when Alec Neil has done that before, dropped big players at big times. So it's no different. I just think it's very difficult sometimes to manage those players when that happens. So I'm not sure how the unrest in the dressing room is going to improve by doing that quite often. I think it just alienates people more than gets them back on side. So I just don't... for the life of me, I can't understand how that makes things better. I just think he's not going to get a reaction from it, certainly from those players. If it was me that was doing that too, I'd be pretty annoyed. And not that you wouldn't want to play for a manager, but it just causes real issues between those players. And they've got friends in the change rooms and other people talk to other people. So I think it just causes internal issues.
Yeah, but I guess a 5-1, you have to make changes. But as you say, you know, how will players respond to being left out? You know, big players like Wes Hoolahan, like Tim Closer, international players. It's just such a mess, isn't it? Week in, week out, it's two steps forward, then five steps back. It's just, it's been a season which has been thrown away for me.
It's like damned if you did and damned if you didn't.
But
in
even,
a way.
But it's just, I was dropping the wrong pit. I know John Reddy made a mistake for the first goal, but actually, I don't think he can really be blamed for the other four not past him. And so I think he was a bit unlucky to be kind of chastised for it and left out. I thought he's played okay in recent weeks. Although McGovern did come in and play well, but I still don't think John deserves to be. And again, Jacob Murphy, we talked about how well he's done this season. We talked about how progressive he's been as a youngster, and he's still learning the game. Yet you drop him, and it's like, well, how does he feel after that?
It was difficult. I guess there were almost two issues, because you had Jacob and Wes, who probably is rested, and then Tim and John, who are literally being dropped.
That's right. I think John to be dropped on the back of, you know, ideally one mistake was harsh. Tim Closer has been an accident waiting to happen game after game, and he's just proved week in, week out, he's not up to the rigours of the Championship. He's bullied far too often, and I, for one, was glad to see him dropped.
He wasn't up to the rigours of the Premier League when he was in that either. It was just, you know, you'd see him towing a caravan at times.
Wow.
He's really struggled.
There were 944 City fans at Ashton Gates last night. But there was also a beam back on at Carrow Road, and we've got a bit of reaction from Sam, who was down at Carrow Road, taking in the joys of Bristol City versus Norwich City on the beam back.
Frustrating and disappointing, and sums up our season perfectly, having to hang on against the team, having won a game in 13. Bringing on Besson for Murphy just shows that he's absolutely off the block, and time for Alex Neil to go and get to that youth blooded in as soon as possible.
Really good point there from Sam, and it's probably been the biggest discussion point, actually, more so than what we talked about, that change late on, Sebastian Besson coming on for Josh Murphy. Effectively, the logic, I think, was sound. It's just that no one likes the logic. The logic is we needed three at the back, Norwich needed three at the back because they were being pummeled and he wanted to leave with a draw against a team that had won one in like 20 games.
Yeah, I felt it was the time when actually you should have been the other way around, where you've just got to go for it. And if you end up losing the game, you lose the game, but you've got to show intent to try and win that game and get yourselves back. Because again, all the other teams around him kind of drew again last night. There's an opportunity to make some points.
Draws won't get you into the playoffs, wins will. And you go for broke, you try and win the game.
Absolutely, yeah. We're at a stage where we just need to be winning literally every single game now, don't we?
I don't think it's a problem. It's a bit bringing a defender on. I think it's probably the fact that it was Besson. People have an issue with him at times anyway.
Which is harsh, honest, because at the moment you could probably take him starting, wouldn't you?
Yeah, but I think it was the way then the team set up. I think if it had changed it around a bit and put two up front or did something a bit different, then people would understand why it was done like that.
We talk about Norwich's abysmal away form. Mm. Norwich have failed to beat all three of the current bottom three sides, and Burton as well. Where do we even start?
Pretty damning, isn't it?
But don't forget, in Alex's first season, his away form was amazing.
Yeah, incredible.
It's just, it's gone, in 2 years, gone full circle, and now they can't buy a win on the road, can they?
And everyone seems to have this obsession, continuing to talk about our record against teams in the top eight or top nine. We can't beat the ones in the bottom three, though, the top eight or top nine. People are obsessed by the top, but we can't even beat the ones at the bottom. You know, we're struggling wherever we go away from home, aren't we? You can almost back us blind against anyone not to win away from home.
We've got to have a word on Yannick Wilshere, because he did score his first goal for the club, and he sounds like a man who wants to at least make an impression. And that is a positive, if you want one.
Well, yeah, it is. I mean, it's taken a while, with all due care. I think he will take time to settle in, and it's very difficult for someone to come in for that kind of price tag into the tiny change room he's come into at the minute. I just think he doesn't know what's hit him. Yeah. It's very difficult to walk into that and kind of see probably the division there is in there. And players will come out, managers will come out and say there is no division. But
that's exactly what he did. Unless you can, obviously. Yeah. Okay, so with another winless away day done and the playoffs almost certainly out of sight, let's get the views of goalscorer Yannick Wilshere and manager Alec Neil on that Bristol City draw.
I think first half, I thought we played some good stuff. I thought we had some good chances. Should have been more than 1-0 ahead at half time with the opportunities we did have. I think second half, they went to a 2 up top and put the big fella on. I thought that caused us some issues. And what happened is, because we lost a few headers, we started dropping deeper and deeper, which meant we didn't have any pressure on the ball further up the pitch. I thought that we didn't work probably at the top end as hard as we did in the first half. And I think that sort of made us sit deeper. And then I felt I had to put our centre back on, you know, because I thought that it was causing us problems. I mean, their team were bigger than ours. And then I thought that certainly helped us when he came on, because defensively it made us barely compete better for headers. I think the frustrating thing from our point of view is the fact that we had probably three or four real good chances to break away and our final ball was poor and we could have finished the game off. And the fact that when the goal comes in, it's a bit mid-height. It's not even a header, you know, and that's really, really frustrating, because I'd expect us to defend that better.
It's hard. I think if you see the first half, we had some good chances, and I think we should have scored more goals. And then you know it's going to be hard. We played the same game with Wigan in the beginning of the season, long balls, and I think with a bit of luck we should have stopped the goal. But yeah, it's 1-1, and I think we should blame ourselves for not scoring more. But in the end, yeah, I think we should have won.
Yeah, I just think that obviously we were winning the game at that stage, and I think as soon as we started losing a couple of headers, then we thought, right, we need to maybe try and protect what we've got, which wasn't what we wanted to do. That wasn't the talk at half-time at all. We spoke about try to finish the game off, try to get the next goal, try to be aggressive and keep the pressure and the tempo which we played it in the first half up. But obviously players will adjust to what's happening within the game. And the fact is, if the ball's continually bouncing about our box, we need to get bodies behind it to make sure we try and protect it.
No, I think this is a real. It was a real championship game, and sometimes you have to do the hard work. You know, it's not always going to be easy, and we know we can play really good. But this now we were asked to defend and win headers, and they have a big team. And I think till the 1-1, we did it well. And yeah, I think we should just go on to the next game now. Saturday is a big game again, so. Hopefully we're going to go in there.
Can you talk to me about the other changes you made tonight? Some big players missing, players like Tim Closer, Wes Houlihan, John Roddy was on the bench. But how many of those changes were down to injuries and how many were down to what happened on Saturday?
Well, I think it's sort of a bit and a bit, really. You know, I think Tim's struggling with my back. So, and then Wes, I thought Wes looked tired at the weekend, so I just felt that bringing him down here wasn't going to do him any good, really. So I just left Wes.
Yeah, and people will look at it and see that those players were left out after a heavy defeat on Saturday. Just clear up where they are with the club at the moment, whether they are completely out of your thoughts or not.
No, they're Norwich City football players, so while they're at the club, they'll be the players for the club.
So let's bring you up to date with the championship picture as it stands. Birmingham and Gianfranco Zola lost their 10th game from the 14 the Italian has been in charge when Leeds won at St Andrews on Friday. Blackburn edged past Wigan in that key game down at the bottom. Fulham kept up the pressure on the top six with the victory over Preston. Forest were surprise winners over high-flying Brighton. And Newcastle continued their charge to the title as they ran out 3-1 winners at Huddersfield. On to last night's results. When all 24 sides were in action, Fulham were unable to close any more ground on the playoff pack but did notch a late equaliser at home to Leeds. Ipswich drew again, their fifth in a row. Brighton got back on track with a comfortable win at Rotherham and Newcastle were held by Reading. So let's take a look at what that means for the Championship bottom half. Bristol City have dropped into the bottom three. However, there are just 3 points between Wigan and Blackburn, who are next up for City at Carrow Road. Birmingham are in complete free fall, although it looks like the good work of Gary Rowett earlier in the season will see them safe. I'm sure he'll appreciate that. At the top, it's still Newcastle and Brighton occupying the automatic spots, although Huddersfield and Reading remain in striking distance. It now appears Fulham are the only side capable of making a late entry into the top six. Their game in hand can see them go within 2 points of the Owls. It's funny, isn't it? We spoke so much about Norwich chasing Sheffield Wednesday. You'd probably argue Fulham could really catch and overtake them, given Sheffield Wednesday's response to beating Norwich 5-1 was to draw at home to Burton.
And was Alex Neil that said it? They're the best team he's seen in the Championship.
On their day,
Fulham, yeah. So, I mean, and you know, they've done pretty well and they have come up on the rails, really, haven't they? And there's always one team that does seem to finish
there
strong.
Is, and I think Fulham could be that team this season, yeah. They score goals, they do let goals in, but they, I mean, for 2-3 years now, they've been a team that score lots of goals, but yeah, they could be the dark horse.
Good manager as well, isn't he, Slavica Jokanovic? Because he did a cracking job at Watford and just kind of got inexplicitly, if I can say it, dumped out of that job. And now he's actually rebeat. Fulham are a case in point, aren't they? I think they've made 25. Got 25 players out of that club.
It's been a huge change in personnel at Craven Cottage, but yeah, he's certainly making his mark on things there and getting his own players in. And they look as the most side realistically that you'd see breaking into that top six and doing something.
I think if you wonder if that's a model that Norwich are trying to look at as well, in terms of they clearly want to stick with Alex Neil. That's been said. They think he's the man for the future. Then it's going to take wholesale changes, as Fulham have done in the last 2 years. So is that what we're going to see in the summer? But how do you shift those players out that are on the money?
That's the issue, isn't it? That's a big issue.
It's all right saying it, but making it happen is a very different thing.
And again, issue we've got Fulham have got owners that have got the money. Yeah. In Norwich are going to find that without the Premier League money, that's where it could become.
Well, the thing is as well, if they don't go up, you're going to go into another season again with doubt before you even start. Mm. And that's something you don't need at a football club. A fresh face or a few new players, it changes that.
higher up, can Huddersfield or Reading catch Brighton, or do you think Brighton kind of got over there?
I think the top two are the best two and will take, I think they're gone. So I think it's playing now for positions 3 down to 6.
I mean, it's interesting, Norwich are going to have a big say in this, but we'll look at their run-in later on, shall we? Dan, you are, of course, a Wolves fan. You were at Portman Road last night.
Now,
were you in a better stadium? Well, not better. Well, no, clearly not a better stadium. Were you at a better game than I was on Tuesday?
It was utterly dreadful. I mean, Ipswich, they were... Wolves were bad. They were worse. It was 0-0, and it was just a shocker. And I paid £35 for a ticket as well.
Wow.
As I said on Sky, that is the worst Ipswich team I've ever seen.
This is actually... Pa-ching! Good to Sky credit. A little bit extra for that. I mean, it is a fair point, and we haven't got long for it, but yeah. The Championship ticket prices away from
outrageous.
Home. The Premier League is capped. I think it was £36 for Norwich fans travelling to Huddersfield, £35 for you.
Yeah.
There's a real issue in the Championship, isn't there, for away fans?
Absolutely, yeah. It's very expensive. How much was it at Sheffield Wednesday?
£36.
Wow. Yeah.
That's more expensive than any Premier League game.
And that doesn't take into account the travelling costs that it takes from Norwich as well, which is three, 4 hours everywhere you go.
You've really got to take your hat off those 900 who made that trip.
Yeah,
incredible figures.
Give them another round of applause. Yeah. There we go. Brilliant stuff. Okay, that is it for part one. When we return, we'll get the views from these guys and Cameron Jerome's post-Sheffield Wednesday interview. Plus, we take your calls, tweets and questions in Talk Is Cheap. Be kind. We will leave you with the pictures and the story of Saturday's horror show. We'll see you in 3.
I was alone when I left my home, staring ahead at the great unknown. I was scared and unprepared. I was looking for somewhere to rest my head. And you said, my love ain't gonna save you. My love, my love. My love ain't gonna change you. My love, my love. Love's not real till it scares you. My love, love's not real till it tears you. My love, my love. You lay there and you let me stare. It's the greatest, deepest love affair. And I'm seeing you now cause I love so loud. So thin they may as well come down. Use your head, it's no use. You're so tangled up, you can hardly
Norwich. Actually, I don't actually know what the score was. I kind of kept it a secret so I could relive it with you right now. So, let's check out what the score was. Okay. Oh no. Dreadful. Horrifying. I didn't think this year could get any worse, and then this happens. People are not happy. Sorry, just reading that steps are getting back together. Just one minute, just going to read that score now. Split. Okay, so Norwich. Let's start with Paddy Davitt. He's kind of an angry, feisty chap. Here we go. He always tells it like it is. Oh. So we lost 5-1. That's not good. But he says we were unlucky. The football was amazing. The referee was terrible. And we never gave up. It's not bad. Let me just try Michael Bailey. He always gets a good review. Some of the best football that I've ever seen away from home this season, and extremely surprised at the unjust result. Ooh. Well, yeah, you can't argue with that. Let's have a look on Twitter, because people are a bit more angry on Twitter, a bit more honest. Let's have a look. Alex Neil forever. I wish we could play like that every week. 5 lucky goals and Jerome scores a worldwide-y. A worldwide-y? Never seen that before. Alex Neil forever again. What's this one say? If Delia doesn't offer him a new contract, I will drink from my own bottle. God knows what that is. Oh, it looks like Alex Neil forever is actually trending. Hashtag Alex Neil forever. Alex Neil forever. Alex Neil forever.
Oh God.
Wow, brilliant. That's pretty much how we all felt on Saturday night, I think.
Well, poor dog happened to lick his face.
That is actually how John normally wakes up. Brilliant work from Johnny Rogers, as always. So hello, I've never called him Johnny before, but there we go. Welcome back to the Pinken Show. He'll like that. It's his fault for saying I said all those things. Welcome back to the Pinken Show with Darren Eadie, Dan O'Hagan and Peter Rogers. And we are live right now on both Mustard TV and our YouTube page.
Live.
Get your comments in on the live YouTube feed. We'll be bringing you those in a little bit. So, following the 5-1 debacle at Sheffield Wednesday on Saturday, City striker Cameron Jerome spoke to the local media and his comments caused somewhat of a reaction. Here is what he had to say.
Been found out on more than one occasion. That's why our away record's so poor. You know, you've got to be honest with yourself, and as players, we're not honest with ourselves. I think, you know, we lack respect for our teammates. You know, we're not fighting for each other. You know, lack respect for the coaching staff. You know, all the stuff they do for us, we don't follow our instructions or orders. It's like everyone plays for themselves. Obviously, there's a lot of fans coming today, 1,700, 1,800, 2,000 fans. It's embarrassing, you know. We're coming in there, drums away from home to support the team, and, you know, ultimately, we've not been good enough again. We've come up short.
It was strong stuff from Cameron. That was only a bit of what he said. He went on to me later on as well. Darren, I mean, have you experienced stuff like that as a player? Have you said stuff like that as a player before?
Not to us openly in public. And to hear it from someone like Cameron Jerome as well, who's normally pretty measured and he looks frustrated. And if anything, it just, I think, highlights the fact that there is some real issues in that changing room. And I think it's fair to say that he's not saying that they don't believe in what the manager's doing or they haven't got respect for them. I think it's the fact that he's saying that the players just aren't carrying it out, that whether they just think they're going to go through games and win games. But I've never seen as damning report from a player like that. I mean, and how do you come back from that? That's the difficulty. I'm not sure where you go from something like that in terms of the changing rooms, because he's clearly pointing the finger at some people. It'd be nice of him to name names, but he's never going to do that. So they will clearly know who he's talking about within the changing rooms. Again, there's going to be that division.
Well, shall we try and name names then? I mean, I guess we've now had Tuesday as a clue, and we've already talked about the fact that Tim Closer missed out. John Reddy, I can't see
senior
that.
Senior player, I don't think he's the kind of person who would rock the boat. But because he's not named names, we're here, you know, trying to pick names out of the air, aren't we? But it does show the dressing room is fractured. Mm. And you do wonder where they go. It does need, doesn't it, either the manager goes or a huge churn of players over the summer.
And, you know, Darren was just saying, I've never known it before. Well, not since Brighton, when Russell Martin came out with very similar, similar quotes. You know, I mean, it's we ship 5 and out they come with the these revelations.
There's nothing unusual for a changing room being fractured like it is at the moment when the team isn't playing well. But sometimes the way you galvanise that and start that again is a new face comes in and all of a sudden the players get together again and they start to create something. When you're not playing well and things aren't going well, there's always little fractures in the changing room. It's not unusual at all.
I mean, both of those, Brighton and the game on Saturday, we didn't necessarily have to have a player put up in front of us. So we are in a situation where the club are at least making people available to speak. Now, whether they regret it afterwards is probably a different point. Alec Neil was very angry on Monday in the press conference immediately after that when he spoke to us about Bristol City. He felt Cam's quotes were maybe taken out of context. Clearly, Cam is I would say he's talking collectively about what the performances are showing. And I think Alec was as angry as I've ever seen him in that.
I think it was a clumsy phrase from Cameron. I think he meant they don't have respect for the coaching staff in that they're not playing
for the coaching staff
to reflect what they're doing. They're working hard to get the players to play the right way, but the players, by the way they're playing, it looks as though they don't respect them.
But he also said they're playing for themselves. The players look like they're playing for themselves rather than doing stuff for the team, which. We had issues with that avenue for a little while, but it felt like it.
Yeah, we have. You can see it in any side that's not performing well. When they've got the quality that Norwich have got, it's because some individuals are treating it differently to others. They're not collectively a team, are they? You know, if that the team, the ability-wise, was collective together, they'd be maybe not walking the league, but they'd certainly be in the playoffs without a shadow of a doubt. But at the moment, they're not.
They are not, indeed. OK, as ever, it's that time of the show where we open it all up to you. This is Talk Is Cheap. Yes, we take your calls, tweets and posts on the key Norwich City issues doing the rounds. There might be one or two key issues doing the rounds at the moment. We've got our first caller on the line already. That is Chris Guns. Thank you so much for taking the time out to ring us, Chris. Much appreciated. It says here you can't believe Maddison and Pritchard aren't in the side at the moment.
Yeah, it's just very strange. You think we'll start building for next year as obviously this season is near enough done with. But he brought on Bassong, and you thought, shall I do opportunity, go for it, bring on the two younger lads.
And especially with someone like James Maddison, I suppose, it almost sums up Norwich's issues this season in terms of shelling out a lot of money for players and presumably needing to give them far more time than actually the reality is what on the pitch is needed. They need those players to come in and do a job immediately. Have you been disappointed that we haven't really seen anything of James Maddison this season?
Oh, yeah, because every time we see him at the under-23s or whatever, or in the Czechoslovakia Trophy end of the season, we scored a lot of goals. I know it's a different kind of opposition, but, you know, he's obviously got the potential, and the poor lad's come here thinking he's got his big break, and we've just not used him.
Thanks so much, Chris. Hold the line. We'll come back to you. I mean, I do think there's a key point here, because Alec Neil's reputation is built around a lot around using young players and developing them. I'm not entirely convinced he trusts them by his time
Maddison,
here.
Why did he come back from Aberdeen mid-season if he's not going to play him?
Yeah. No, I think Alec wanted to send him back, and basically it was James who said, no, let me work my way into
it. It's a very difficult thing to manage with younger players to come through. It's the one thing I've been surprised at. I wasn't surprised to bring him on against Bristol City, because I think if a team is struggling, it can be hard for a youngster to come in and that can almost break them sometimes, depending on what's going on in the changing room. So it's very difficult to do that. I've been surprised when he hasn't put youngsters on. I had youngsters on the bench when they've battered players teams like Brentford, Forest. That's when you stick them on for the last 10, 15 minutes when the things are going well. Yeah. And when they have got good spells this season, he still hasn't done that. And that's what the opportunity to do, I think.
I just think now the season is as good as over. The games are sort of dead rubbers, aren't they? We need to be building for next season. We need to get a new manager in now. He must come in, have a look at his squad, evaluate it, look at the players we've got, decide what he wants to do in the summer and take things from there. And that means playing the Maddisons, the Godfreys.
Exactly.
Give them a game. You've got to get them in and have a look at them. Wes, we love him to bits. We know what he can do. Let's see what Pritchard can do.
Now is the time to build.
Absolutely.
You know, we've got 10 games to go, then a whole summer. Let's get it done now, and then next season we'll hit the ground running.
Great enthusiasm and passion in here. One for you, though, Chris. Alec Neil sticks in the youngsters, and they get beaten in their next two home games. Does that give Alec Neil more credit and more time with the City fans?
I think it would do, yeah. I think a lot of the fans, from what you see on Twitter, especially saying, look, give them a chance. And the only way you'll find out if they can't do it is by giving them the game time they need.
stuff, Chris. Thank you so much for your call.
The problem is that doesn't then give you, as much as the youngsters might come in and might do okay, that still doesn't take away the fact that you've got to shift those older players that are on big money. It almost makes it a bit harder because they're not even playing.
Yeah,
so
that's
it. It is difficult.
There was another interesting point from my chat with Cameron Jerome after Saturday, actually, where he basically said, look, players can't take criticism anymore. When I was coming through, the senior players would hammer me, even if I was playing well, and they were having a bad game. Was that how it was when you were coming
through? Yeah, without a doubt. Yeah, I mean, they were...
And do you think that's different now?
Yeah, definitely. Players, it's all down to individual personalities, but some players don't care anymore. You can say what you like to them. Manager won't care. The players won't care what a manager says, what do the players say to them. There's a lot of individuals like that in the game nowadays. It's pretty cutthroat. But certainly, as I was coming through in the team, you'd have those older pros that would get stuck into you. You know, they did for the first 6 months to a year, you get away with it a little bit. They'd let you off. But then as soon as you got in that environment again, they would let you know when you weren't doing the right things.
We've got our next caller on the line, which is Robin Sainty, I believe. Robin, good evening. Lovely to speak to you. Of course, a member of the Canaries Trust. And I think you've been a busy boy since Tuesday night.
not sure that writing one email is particularly busy, Michael. But yeah. Yeah, we did send an email to the club this morning, basically suggesting that if, as I suspect is the case, they're going to continue to back Alex Neil, that it would actually be quite nice if they explained to the fans what their reasoning was, because I think people are entitled to know that, given that 1,000 people travelled to the West Country. Some of them are arriving back at 3:30 this morning and saw yet another abject display.
Yeah, it's an interesting point, isn't it, Robin? Because you know, we get fans a lot of the time wanting to hear from the board, but I guess there becomes a tipping point every so often. And you clearly feel that we're now at a tipping point in this season where, you know, the board need to say something. What would you like them to say in that instance?
Well, I would just like them to give the fans some information. At the end of the day, I suspect that any response that we get isn't going to be something that the majority of people particularly want to hear, because I suspect that their intention is to keep Alex Neil in post. But as I say, I think it would be better all round. I mean, better from the club's point of view, not just the fans' point of view, if the rationale was laid out there, because I think people would actually respect the fact that they were being given a justification for it, because at the moment I think most of us are looking at and thinking, why the heck is this being allowed to go on?
Steph, Robin, we'll come back to you, and thanks not for swearing.
I think it's quite interesting at the moment, because I think it's got to the point where I can see Alex Neil, I can see the fans, I can see the media, I can see people within the club all pointing at players. I can all see them pointing the finger at other players. So they've almost manipulated it into a situation where it's the players' fault. And rightly so, some of it has been. They haven't proved themselves this season. They haven't done well enough. So it's almost taken the pressure off Alex Neil a little bit, in the sense that the board think it's the players' fault. It's the players' fault. We want him in position. Let him build his squad. And then we go again from there. And that's what it feels like to me, is if it's been a bit like, we've pushed it all onto the players, it's the players. And even the players now coming out and saying it's the players.
But you know what, I mean, this awful season, apart from that disastrous Jez Moxey interview, we've not heard from the owners once, which just beggars belief.
Well, I think the lack of the CEO at the moment is creating some sort of vacuum. And I have to say, I hate this logic with just blaming it on the players, because ultimately the manager's sole responsibility is to get the most out of his players.
Of course it is, and I think this is, Robin's made a very good point there with his call, hasn't he? I think what people want to know, what fans want to know, is what is Alex Neil doing that's good? Are we going to be promoted? No. Are we winning games? No. Are the players improving from his coaching? No. Has he got a wonderful eye for spotting players in the lower division, the non-league, and unearthing some gems? No. What is he doing that's good?
But the thing is, well, again, that comes down to recruitment again. That comes down to the players that they've recruited in. You know, Alex Neil might well be a fantastic manager, but if you've got the wrong type of players all in that same changing room, it's inevitable what's going to happen, what's happening.
And clearly the problems aren't solely about the manager, absolutely. Robin, we'll get one more from you. I mean, clearly most of all we've heard from the board so far this season has been about aiming for promotion, so we now know that's out of the way. All the Norwich City fans you've spoken to, do you see that there are many who feel that Alex Neil is the right man to turn the club around and to oversee this massive rebuilding project that looks like it's going to be arriving?
think you'd be struggling to find too many today, Michael, in all honesty. I mean, we've had an absolute barrage of emails and contacts from people saying, you know, why aren't you saying something about this? You know, enough is enough. I think that the vast majority of fans now just don't see this situation improving.
Robin, thank you so much for your time. Much appreciated. We'll wait with bated breath to see if the club reply and what they say, of course. We're going to get our final caller on the line in a moment. We've got some messages on the live chat on the YouTube, which is great. Shall we rattle through some of these?
The YouTube.
We're in Norwich.
Yeah.
We're in Norfolk.
YouTube.
Rory Ives says, this is what a mid-table season looks like. Not had one for a long time, which is true, isn't it? I used to have a season ticket. It was full of mediocrity. 14,000 at Carrow Road.
I played it.
Bless you. I was watching you, Darren. Yeah. Sorry about that, Darren. But, you know, people do get a bit fogged by how Norwich have been in the last 7 to 10 years, don't they?
But I also think that was a little bit understandable back then as well, because the situation the football club was in terms of administration and all that, whereas now there was an opportunity to stay in the Premier League.
We weren't in receipt of the parachute payments and that type of thing and 25,000-plus crowds week in, week out, were we? I mean, yeah, let's be honest, we haven't got any God-given right to be promoted. No. There's no doubt about that. But I think fans have got the right to feel they've been a bit shortchanged this season.
And the fans don't want to see what's happened at Ipswich year on year of just limbo in this division.
It's spot on. Dave Butcher sent a message. The board doesn't speak. The manager talks twaddle. Respect Cam Jam. There we go. We've got our final caller on the line as well, which is Mark Jones. Mark, we haven't got very long. I'm so sorry, but please tell us what you're thinking.
Deep frustration within the football club at the moment.
Absolutely. It says here, going to take a collection bucket to raise £2 million to sack Alec Neil on Saturday?
That would be ideal. But, I've been a season ticket holder for over 20 years now. Been to Munich, been to Arnhem. Don't think I've ever felt so frustrated and so wound up by the football club at the minute.
And just one thing I want to touch on, Mark. I get quite a lot of messages saying, oh, it's down to the media and we should be instigate, or, you know, if there was a protest move, we should be trying to help facilitate that. But it's got to come from the fans, surely, if they do want change, to do that themselves.
You can't kind of burn your own bridges, can you? So it is down to the fans to do something about it, definitely. I mean, I can see at the moment it going back to the Chase days of riots up and down Carrow Road and, yeah, it's just the way it's going. I mean, the thing what really upsets me at the moment is there's no voice from the fans to the board of directors. There's nothing from Delia. There's not even been a vote of confidence for Alex Neil. So we're kept in the dark, really. So that's the most frustrating thing about it.
Thanks for your call, Mark. I'm not too worried about burning any bridges, to be honest, because this is the way the world is.
You had a good go at that, haven't you?
It wasn't the sole aim, but I think it just happened.
You blamed me earlier for the fitness.
Well, this is
blaming you for that.
Don't blame me for it. There's nothing to do with that. We've got a couple of messages. Here we go. David Vincent, how long has the manager got on his contract? He's got a rolling 12-month contract, I believe. Not that will really matter, to be honest. Mark Waters, it beggars belief Alec Neil is still at the club. Any other club would have sacked him long ago, unless you're Lee Johnson and Bristol City. As always, thanks for all your calls and tweets. Talk is Cheap will be back next week, and if you want to sing praises or vent frustrations, simply send us an email, sport@mustardtv.co.uk. It's time for our final break tonight. When we return, we'll look towards Saturday's visit of Tony Mowbray's Rovers, plus we dissect City's final 10 games of the season. See you in three. Hello and welcome back to the final part, that was brief, of this evening's Finken Show with Darren Eadie, Dan O'Hagan and Peter Rogers. Now, before we discuss the weekend's visit of Blackburn, for many, the playoffs are out of reach already and City season is all but done. However, there's no room for any relaxing. City's final 10, they are definitely 10 fixtures, by the way, final 10 fixtures, see them come up against six of the division's top nine sides. Can have a look at those fixtures now. Don't be too scared.
So we can't beat the top, we can't beat the bottom. Who are we beating?
That's a good question. I don't think we've beaten anyone since the first few weeks. Blackburn, 4-1, opening day of the season. But there we go. So Blackburn and Barnsley at home. That rounds off March, basically, because we then have an international break. And then April arrives with its joyous daffodils. And Norwich have five games in the space of 17 days. I cannot wait for all these trips. Aston Villa, Huddersfield midweek in front of the Sky cameras. Preston, no, what was the one? I can't remember the one at the bottom.
Reading
at home. Then over Easter, Fulham at home on Good Friday. Preston away on Easter Monday. Brighton then at home, they're apparently pretty good. And Leeds away, penultimately, before QPR arrive and Norwich might actually win another game. I mean, after these two home games, April, how hard is that?
Difficult.
Yeah, it is though, but looking, I think, this is the Championship and at the start of the season, we'd be looking at our fixture list thinking,
isn't August, Darren.
expectations have slipped.
Yeah.
This squad should not be in a position where we're looking at those games saying, oh, that's tough.
That's a tough one.
This squad should beat any team in that division.
But that is
the
reality.
Frustration because they have done it at times. They've battered teams 5-0, 5-1. They can do it, but the consistency is just all over the shop at the minute, particularly away from home.
And that's why Norwich are going to play a big part in the promotion shake-up.
Chris Hughton
or no part at all.
Not for themselves.
Chris Hughton to seal promotion at Carrow Road, do you think? Cool. Three games in the end?
Thanks, Pete. I hope there's no clappers and no one throws any clappers around at him. I mean, the complete falling apart of Norwich's season when we think back to what happened, you know, in August and hammering Blackburn. I mean, the manager, ultimately, we're giving the responsibility to him for him.
Partly, yeah, but I also think, again, recruitment has been poor. I don't know how many times we've said over the last 3 years we need some defence. We need some defending players.
It's the same faces we've had for four years here.
So what happens from here, then? We mentioned
clearly we've got to have a new manager for the start of next season, sooner the better. But that isn't the only problem, is it? You know, there's a lot wrong at Norwich City at the moment, bar the, you know, not just
Chief
the manager.
Chief exec, players, the manager we've mentioned. It's just an unholy mess from top to bottom. It really is.
And with no one really trying to steer it in any direction at the moment. That's what it feels like.
There's
stuff going on behind the scenes we don't see, and they're preparing statements and all this. But at the moment, it just feels rudderless.
I think it is what it feels like, and it is a perception thing. The club are clearly trying to do some sort of root and branch restructuring behind the scenes so that when they do decide who their new chief executive is going to be, and I don't think it's going to be someone like a David McNally or a Jez Moxey, they'll then have this leadership vacuum
filled. But did we know at the time how significant losing McNally would be a year and a half ago? It's been such a rudderless ship ever since, hasn't it, really?
But again, I get a little bit frustrated with that because, as well as David did in his time here, it's down to the players on the football pitch and the manager to make things happen. Being a chief exec at a football club like Norwich, I think sometimes can be easier than other football clubs if you're doing well on the football pitch. Yeah. And they're just not doing well on the pitch.
So who would we like to see play between now and the end of the season? Who needs a game?
Madison, give him a game. Check him in.
Fancy game, Michael?
I'd definitely put my heart and soul into it. I'd be terrible. No one would pay to watch. Jake says he could play in goal, but we know that's a really, really, really bad idea.
Got to see something in Madison and Godfrey, definitely. They look really two good, promising young players.
Forget about Pritchard. He's so young. Just seen none of him. And what is he, £8 million? I'm shaking my head now, Alex. I'm shaking mine. Okay, so I think back to the opening day of the season, August. Norwich City kicked off their Championship campaign with a stellar 4-1 win at Ewood Park with some lovely football, which left many predicting a successful season for the Canaries. Fast forward to March, it's not exactly panned out how Alec Neil would have hoped. Things have hardly been plain sailing for Rovers either. So these are the fixtures at the weekend. I haven't seen these. I've literally only come back from Bristol. So what have we got there? Ipswich head to Barnsley. Lucky them. That's nice. Sheffield Wednesday at Aston Villa. Be interesting.
Fulham,
Brighton
Newcastle.
Derby. Fulham, Newcastle. I hadn't got that far. That'll be tasty, won't it? We'll enjoy Fulham, Newcastle. Wolves, your side. Home to Rotherham, Dan.
If we can't beat Rotherham, then we are doomed.
Preston, Reading. That's an interesting one. Leeds should win. At home to QPR.
It's quite interesting.
In-depth analysis. How do you feel of Brentford?
It's always interesting. It's looking at those stats. Every week we look at those stats on the team that's coming up this week, and they always seem to favour Norwich. And then it just all goes wrong.
Yeah, it doesn't happen. Yeah. The one there, Blackburn, obviously had a shocking season. I actually thought that Owen Coyle wouldn't last until Christmas, so it did pan out a bit better for him than I thought it was back in August. But Norwich's defensive record is in the bottom three in the Championship. Well, it certainly was before the weekend. I don't know if it's different now.
It has been for the
last
3 seasons.
That is literally a League One defence, if you translate that.
Yeah, and it has been, and it's alarm bells that were ringing.
And we're seeing, no matter how you shuffle back, no matter who plays in that defence, the same problems are there. They can't defend set pieces, they give cheap goals away, individual mistakes, no matter who plays.
And I do find myself harking back to Bournemouth away last season, the Villa complete no-show. I mean, it's hard to separate what happened, you know, in the Premier League, albeit at a higher level, to what's ended up happening this year.
It's just been a continuation of the same theme, hasn't it, realistically, you know, particularly away from home.
I think it's almost too many of the same players in the same positions. Yes. Actually,
same player, not, same managers.
Yeah, not too much, not enough recruitment in the right areas. Mm. I mean, it's not rocket science at times, is it?
You wouldn't have thought so. Friday Sports Extra will have all the top lines from City's pre-match press conference. You'll also be able to catch the highlights on our YouTube channel, which is, of course, Norfolk Now. Right, big question then. Who to pick for Saturday's visit from Blackburn Rovers? How exciting. Who's got an 11? Have we got any 11s?
I've got one.
Peters. Oh, wait for yours, Dan. Wait for yours. Peters, you're going.
Yeah,
there you go.
I've gone with John back in goal. I think he was harshly treated to be dropped after the one mistake at Sheffield Wednesday. Not a big fan of McGovern. The back four, for all its problems, probably picks itself. I think Closer just isn't at it at Championship level. Just want to see Pritchard given a go behind Jerome, really, and young Godfrey in midfield as well. I think Alex Tetti, is he the future? Probably not. Godfrey might well be, so I'd like to see him given a go. Wilshut, we haven't been over-enamoured by what we've seen of him, but he got himself on the score sheet in midweek, and I'd like to see him carry on the... give it another go at home.
Yeah, there's 2 points there. Yannick surely has to start on Saturday.
For me, it's not so much about the personnel, it's the way they set up and how they play the game. I'd like to just try and play with a bit of width, because every time they have done that, particularly with someone like Dykes, they've got in. But they tend to play so narrow, the two wingers pushing right ins, obviously, to play off Pritchard or whoever it is up front, or Jerome. But just play with some width. But, you know, try something a little bit different, because at the moment, we all kind of know what we're going to get.
Yannick does have to start there, doesn't he?
He's got to. Get him out wide. Get him running at people.
Exactly. And Ben Godfrey, I find, a really interesting one, because we've seen him a couple of times this season parachuted in midfield, not literally. And I haven't seen nothing there to think, well, you couldn't have a go in the Championship. But they prefer him as a centre-back. And I just wonder if they're like, well, we don't really want to play you there too much because we're going to play you at centre-back. What does that matter if the guy can play there? And he played, I would tell you, where he played for York City before Norwich signed him.
Absolutely, yeah. Just get him in the team and let's see what he can do. You know, that's the thing, isn't it? I think people are crying out to see him, the Madisons of this world, Pritchard more regularly, and you know, let's see what they can do.
Dan, should we have a look at your 11?
Let's do.
Boom.
Again, I've gone with John in goal, because McGovern, I just do not rate as a goalkeeper. I think Ruddy all round is technically better, gives the defence more belief. And I've brought in Madison, because I think it's now or never. Give the guy a go. Paid a big fee for him, chuck him in.
That is a really hard one now, isn't it? Because you play Madison. What does Alex Pritchard think if you start with Madison? It's a difficult one, isn't it?
But again, that problem having too many players who play in the same position.
Yes, that's very true.
That's the recruitment again, isn't it?
If only we could have seen that in the summer and known that was going to happen. Yeah. I guess we should all be in agreement here. John Ruddy isn't going to be put back into
I don't think he will, but he should be.
But even just looking at these two different systems and different setups, this sums Norwich's seasons up, doesn't it? Because a good side picks itself. And we haven't, I mean, how many times I've sat here this season, looked at different setups, different teams, and they've all been different.
I mean, we sort of lambasted the recruitment a lot, but that fact about having too many players in one role and then not enough
in
others.
It's crazy.
That's symptomatic. I mean, they're simple, straightforward choices. Yeah. And the first few transfer windows Alec Neil was here, he literally wrote off the first summer transfer window ahead of the Premier League because they were restructuring it. Mm-hmm.
But we've got an abundance of these nice, small, clever touch players, haven't we? Houlihan, Naismith, Madison, Pritchard. The two Murphys as well, to a certain extent. You look at what's coming through from the academy, Glenn Middleton, the boy Cantwell. These small, nice, clever touch players. Where are the Andrew Crofts, the Gary Holts, the aggressive midfield ball-winning players that we really do need, not to mention, obviously, decent centre-halves?
Got to be addressed this summer. I mean, can it be? Do we have any faith in the guys?
One thing I think is clear is defenders are going to be cheaper than anywhere else on the pitch. They tend to be, so it's not going to cost as much, I don't think, to bring some of those players in. But I don't think it's the trouble bringing the players in; it's shifting the ones they need to get rid of before they can bring anyone in. And that's the real trouble they're going to have because they haven't performed.
We should touch on Blackburn, shouldn't we, I suppose? Tony Mowbray's in charge there now, and they've actually done quite well since he's come in. That's good news.
He's scummer.
Yeah, he's got the defence sorted out, which has been noticeable in the last couple of games. I think they got a draw, didn't they, midweek with a late equaliser. Signs are that they're on the turn, which for Norwich, of course, is bad news.
See, that has been my major issue. Bring in a manager, he can reorganise a side. Same personnel,
start from the back.
He's reorganised them, and they look more solid.
Starts from the back as well, doesn't it? Building from the back.
It's not rocket science.
And he was a defender, wasn't he? Yeah. So you tend to find a lot of them will start that, get a strong back line before they then work forward.
And let's be honest, though, at the same time, Blackburn fans will feel, what are Norwich fans complaining about?
Absolutely,
look at the guys running our club.
Imagine, having to call for Tony Mowbray to bail you out. Things must be quite bad, mustn't they? That said, I went to Ewood Park first game of the season. They look dreadful. But you start to look at the players they have got, the likes of Danny Graham. I think they're probably just a little bit too good to go down. I think they could survive.
Yeah. Ironically, Norwich's home form is still pretty good. I think they've only... Have they lost once since Huddersfield?
December 16th,
so that was the last defeat. Huddersfield?
Yeah. I mean,
that's a great home record.
It is, but it's an appalling away record.
That's why we're sitting in mid-table, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is literally mid-table obscurity. Do all right when you're at home, do terrible when you're away, you're going to be stuck in the middle, aren't you?
Yeah. We'll see. There'll be 27,000 there, I'm sure, anyway, to see what it is. Predictions then. Go on then, Darren. What do you reckon?
Oh, do you know what? It's just pie in the sky.
Come
Who
on.
Knows anymore?
Come on, we're
nearly
there.
I always say they're going to win. I'm going to go for a 2-0 home win.
2-0 home win.
6-0.
6-0?
No idea.
You spent
too
long at Portman Road in midweek. That's your problem.
2-0 home win to carry on papering over those cracks, I think.
Yeah, that's it.
Which we've kind of been there before, haven't we? I mean, you mentioned Chris Hughton earlier. That he was the master of getting results just when he needed it, wasn't he? And that's, are we there? Is that what's happened?
I think it is, yeah. I think he kept himself in a job winning those 3 or 4 games that he did in a row. But all of a sudden, it drops away again now, and it will continue to happen again. Win a few, lose a few.
As you said earlier in the season. That is us done for tonight. Well done for surviving. We'll do it all again on Saturday when the Pink and Match Day returns to mop up all the post-match analysis and reaction from in and around the ground once the full-time whistle has sounded at Carrow Road. Stay tuned to mustardpinken.com and all of our social feeds until then as we bring you all the latest coming out of Colney as we build up to that clash with Blackburn. And don't forget to tune in next week when we do this all over again live on YouTube and Mustard from 7 p.m. next Wednesday. Thanks to everyone who called, commented or tweeted. Thanks to the three up front beside me, Darren Eadie, Dan O'Hagan and Peter Rogers. And most of all, thanks to you all for watching. Good night and don't have nightmares.